Religion is meant to promote harmony, universal brotherhood, coexistence. Religion should not create hatred. So that was the main thrust of Guru Nanak's philosophy. And Guru Nanak, the first policy statement he issued when he started the journeys of the entire Asia, Na hum Hindu, na Musliman. We are neither Muslims nor Hindus. We are humans. We are all humans. We must learn to live together. Guru Nanak traveled the entire India. Then he went to China, Tibet. Then he came to Arabian areas. Then he came to the Mediterraneans. He walked on foot for about 28 years. And he walked for 45,000 miles the entire world. He went to all the places of worship, whether these belong to Hindus, whether these belong to Muslims. He went to Haridwar, he went to Kurukshetra, he went to Allahabad, he went to Jagannath Puri, all Hindu places of worship. And then he went to Makkah, the most sacred place for the Muslims. And the very interesting thing is, Guru Nanak took with him Mardana. Guru Nanak was a poet. Whenever he will sit in a meditative mood, he will sing the praises of God. And the Mardana, he was an instrument player. He will play on Arabica, Rabab, and they will sing together. Muslim and Nanak. Friends, he was born in a Hindu family. Guru Nanak was born in a Hindu family. But he made friendship with Muslim because he wanted to convey the idea that Hindus and Muslims cannot be separated. And one thing very interesting happened when Guru Nanak left this world. When he heaved his last breath in a place known as Kartarpur, Hindus and Muslims are fighting. Fighting on what? Hindu will say, it is our Guru. We will cremate it. And Muslim say, no, he is our peer. We will bury it, like the Muslims do. So there was a conflict. Every Hindu, every Muslim loved Guru Nanak because his message was that we are all humans. We should not create hatred among various religious denominations. And after Guru Nanak, the message continued. And we had 9 more gurus. Our 5 gurus, first 5 gurus, they were poets. They wrote poetry, devotional poetry. And then 9th guru also wrote devotional poetry. The first book was compiled in the year 1604. 1604, the first book of the Sikhism, the Granth, the Holy Granth was compiled. And it was installed in Harimandir Sahib, Golden Temple, which is popularly known now, at that temple, which is in the city of Amritsar. And the beauty of this book, holy book, was that it contained compositions of 35 poets. Among 35, only 5 were our gurus, and 30 others had Muslims, Hindus, so-called low-caste people, high-caste people, Brahmins. So the idea was to create a platform for entire mankind. A granth, a book for every human, which should give the message of universal brotherhood. So that was the first time that in the 1604, our fifth guru, his name was Guru Arjan Dev, he compiled the book. And the second thing he did, he built the golden temple known as Harimandir Sahib. The real name is Harimandir Sahib, the temple of God. Hari means God. Temple of God in Amritsar. And it was given four doors, because in traditional Hindu temples there was only one door. You could enter from that door. And there were restrictions as well. Low caste people could not enter a temple. Guru Arjan Dev built the temple with four doors, conveying the ideas that people from all directions, all denominations, may be rich, may be poor, they can all come to the temple and join the prayer. So now, even if you go to our Sikh temple, Gurdwara, you will find you may not be a Sikh. There's no restrictions. Anybody can come and pray there. And again, women and men, they have equal rights in Sikh. That was a very big problem at that time, because in Hindu temples, there were so many Hindu temples where women could not go and pray. But Guru Nanak gave the message that all are respectable. Our women have an important role to play in the society, so we should not hate them. They should be given equal rights with the Sikhs. Our women, they can become religious preachers also. They can sing, they can do kirtan in the temple. So this was the other thing which Guru Nanak preached. Now, in the year 1604, our first granth was installed in Harimandir Sahib. As I told you, it was written by fifth guru. It was compiled by fifth guru, Guru Arjan Dev. And after 2 years, in the year 1606, he was martyred at the orders of a fanatic king, Mughal king, Jahangir. He was murdered because the Muslim rulers of Delhi at that time, they were intolerant against all of the religions. So he became our first martyr also. Thereon, later on, we had to face so many difficulties in our history. About 99 years after Guru Gobind Singh, our 10th guru, we fought against the Mughal Empire. The Sikhs lived in the forests. They could not live in the towns or villages because they were tortured. Their houses were looted and they were butchered like anything. So they withdrew to the jungles, forests. They lived there for 99 years and fought against the Muslim rulers, not Muslim, Muslim rulers, who were fundamentalists and fanatics. So they fought. And ultimately, in the year 1799, after 91 years after Guru Gobind Singh, we were able to root out the Mughal Empire from the state of Punjab. And the Sikh Empire was created. Sikh Raj was created there in the state of Punjab. And that became a very, very important part of our history. For 45 years, the Sikhs were the ruler of the Punjab. And Ranjit Singh was the king of Punjab, who was Khalsa. He based his empire on the doctrines preached by Guru Sahib for 10 gurus and Granth Sahib. And our Granth, which was installed in the 1604, was again recompiled by Guru Gobind Singh, because he added to it the composition written by the 9th Guru, which were not in the earlier essential. And that was the Granth, Holy Granth, which was ultimately compiled by Guru Gobind Singh Ji, 10th Guru, that was given the status of Guru. And the Guruship went to the book after that. And Guru, after the Sikh Empire, in the 1849, the Sikh Empire was also finished by the British rulers. The British were ruling over India for 100 years, but they could not annex Punjab, the Sikh Empire. But ultimately, by their diplomatic efforts and other methods adopted by them, ultimately the Sikh Empire came to an end, and Punjab became part of British Empire. And during this time, during the British Empire, for about 100 years, up to 1947, the Sikhs fought against the British ruler as well. And India got freedom from the British, and the Sikhs played a dominant role in that movement, freedom movement of India. And as Mr. Chris was telling you, we had to suffer a lot of atrocities at that time. And I personally watched all those things happen as a small child, small kid. The train in which I was traveling, there was a total migration of the Sikhs and Hindus to this side, and Muslim to that side, and thousands of people were killed everywhere. So after 1947, so we are being now ruled by a democratic government in which we are participating. Punjab is very important part of India, and I am proud that in India, democracy is flourishing like anything. That is the largest democracy of the world. So this is the story of Sikhism. And now I will tell you a few things about the philosophy of Guru Granth Sahib Ji. What our Guru Granth Sahib says. There are two parts of Sikhism. One is the spiritual aspect of the Bani of Guru Granth Sahib Ji. What is God? How the world was created? And what is this human soul? What is Jeev? These are all philosophical issues dealt in Guru Granth Sahib. And the crux of the essence of the entire philosophy is God is one. And this creation is with his will. Whenever he wills, he creates this world. And when he created it, it came to his mind and he created it. In Guru Granth Sahib, it is written, all the endless expanse of creation arose out of one note. He said, be it, and it became. One note giving rise to millions of streams. How may I compute and express the God's might? Guru Nanak says, I cannot express how it was done. And the other thing which is most important, the Sikhism is very scientific. We have now made so much progress in the field of science, and there are many religious ideas, and sometimes you compare with the science and you find that it is not true, it is just mythology. But in Sikhism, whatever you find in Guru Granth Sahib can be judged on the anvil of scientific truth, and you will find they are the same. One thing I will specifically mention, in our traditional religions before Guru Nanak, there was an idea that we have this world, then there's seven worlds in the sky, then seven under this earth, and there are so many others. But Guru Nanak says, Patala Patal Lakh Agasa Agas. What does it mean? Of neither worlds and heavens has he created millions. Now the science is saying there are so many galaxies, there are so many worlds, you cannot count. Has he created millions, men have given up the account in despair. The Vedas too declare unanimously their helplessness. Muslim scriptures declare the number of species 18,000. Vain is such account, nothing is real but the one essence. Guru Nanak means to say that you cannot count, you cannot make a judgment what he can do. You cannot reach the limit. His action, whatever he wants, they are limitless beyond the comprehension of the human brain. We cannot understand. Then the soul. Sikhism believes that we are a soul. God is super soul, and we are separated from him. And it is our endeavor to meditate on him, because he has given this human life to meditate, to sing his praises, to do good work. And our ultimate aim is to get union with him. So this is the main essence of Sikhism. This human body, it has nothing to do, it has no value, it will perish. But the soul is immortal. It will remain because it is separated from him. It will ultimately go to him, and it should be our effort. We should live life in such a way that we can re-seek union with Vaheguru God. Then, what was before this world was created? All this world was created. And Sikhism believes, Guru Granth Sahib believes, there was all darkness, and there was this state of nothingness. And when it came to his mind, God's mind, it was created. For millions upon millions, countless years, was spread darkness. There is some similarity with Bible here. When existed neither earth nor sky, but only the limitless divine ordinance. Then existed neither day or night, no sun or moon. The creator into unbroken trance was absorbed. So this is the basic word about the creation in Sikhism, in Guru Granth Sahib. And in Sikhism, it starts with what are the attributes of God. Our Granth, Holy Granth, starts with this line: Ek Omkar Satnam Karta Purkh Nirbhav Nirvay Akal Mool Adyuni Sahib Amar Prasad. Ek Omkar, God is one. God is one. He is the sole supreme being of eternal manifestation. He is creator, immanent reality, without fear, without rancor, timeless form, unincarnated, self-existent, realized by grace of the holy preceptor. Because the importance of Guru is eulogized throughout the Guru Granth Sahib. Guru is very important. Only Guru can tell us what we are to do and how to get the union with Akal Purakh Waheguru. And similarly, in primal time, God, in primal time, in all time, was the creator. He is every time, he is everywhere. Omnipresent, omnipotent, omniscient. Nothing is real but the eternal. Nothing shall last but the eternal. Now the Sikhs, what do the Sikhs do in their ordinary life? There are three basic things in Sikhism. They are kirt karna, naam japna, te band ke chakna. Kirt means you have to work. A Sikh cannot sit idle. He has to work and earn his livelihood by honest means. This is a must for a Sikh. That is kirt. Naam japna, then you have to meditate on God. Meditation. Remember him. Always keep in mind that whatever I am doing, he is seeing. He is overseeing power. I should not do anything which annoys him. So a Sikh is supposed to do meditation. Naam japna. Second, and in the third thing is vand ke chakna. To share your earnings with others the needy. You have to help the poor. And in Sikhism, there is an institution called the Swand. The Swand means giving 10th part of your income for the social welfare to the needy, to the poor. 1/10. If you earn 1,000, then you have to give 100 to the for the welfare of the society. So this is your duty. That is what we call charity in our Western society. So that's one. And a Sikh is supposed to be helpful to everybody. One thing I finish with very important happening in our history. Our 9th Guru, his name was Guru Tegh Bahadur. Sikhism, though started in the backdrop of Hinduism, but it was different because it was against idol worship and there are so many other things. But at the time of Guru Tegh Bahadur, in the year 1675, Aurangzeb, the Mughal ruler, who was very oppressive, tyrannical, fundamentalist, who broke down, down to the ground so many Hindu temples in India, and so many people were converted to Islam forcibly. And all the Hindus who were being converted forcibly came to Guru Tegh Bahadur, our 9th Guru. One thing you should remember, that all our gurus are known as Nanak. Nanak 1, Nanak 2, Nanak 3, Nanak 4, Nanak 5. Though they have different names, but they always are mentioned in the name of Nanak. Because the spiritual light is the same. So Guru Tegh Bahadur was holding a darbar in Anandpur Sahib, another famous town in India, in Punjab. And the Hindus said that Aurangzeb is forcibly converting us to Islam. Please help us. Guru Tegh Bahadur went to Delhi and told Aurangzeb that he should not indulge in such activities. Because you cannot become a good ruler if you don't allow freedom of practicing religion. Aurangzeb was very fanatic and he ordered that Guru Tegh Bahadur be converted to Islam or he should be allowed to die. Guru Tegh Bahadur accepted death for the sake of saving the religion of the Hindus. He was not a Hindu, but he fought for it. I mean to say, a Sikh is supposed to help everybody, every religion, and though he may or may not believe in that, but he should die, he should be ready to die for the basic fundamental right of freedom of practice of religion. So this was the greatest contribution of Sikhism, that we can die not for our own religion, for the others also. So in this way, this is the story of Sikhism. And if you have any question, you can ask me. Yes.
How many gurus are there at one time? Is it just one guru at a time?
One guru at a time. When the first guru goes, the second is
when
installed.
When they pass away?
Then second is installed.
And how do they choose?
It is always the selection is made on merit by the first. The main criteria of selection is service, volunteer service, and other things to how he can lead, how he can disseminate the principles which are given by Guru Nanak. So after 10th Guru, it went on like this. And after that, the book became.
What do Sikhs believe happen after a Sikh dies?
After
death, what do Sikhs believe happen?
After death?
Yes.
Yes, it's a very important question. The Sikhs believe in reincarnation. This soul is in a cycle of birth and death. And it is our duty to meditate on God and pray for His grace that I should be saved from this cycle of birth and death, and I should become united with the super soul that is God. It is happening again and again. It is called transmigration of soul. Soul changing clothes. This body is called just like clothes, as we change clothes. Soul is also doing this. But the ultimate aim of the soul is to get union with super soul.
So do you reincarnate as a human or anything? When you reincarnate?
Anything.
How do you determine that?
I can't. This is the belief.
Is it like a karma-based system? Is it kind of like a karma-based system?
It is very difficult to explain. Very difficult to explain. This is all supernatural.
But you can come to the Gurudwara and sit for hours. And,
you are welcome to.
There's no hurry. You can get answers to your questions.
And see how we perform our service there. And one thing very important institution of Sikhism is langar, free kitchen. Everywhere in the world, wherever you go, you will get free food.